that being the land of Edom, and to hating Esau in Malachi 1 and Obadiah. And so this letter of Obadiah details this, and it starts out with the prophet Obadiah having a vision. Now, in Hebrews 1, verse 1, the author of Hebrews says that God at sundry times and in diverse manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets, Obadiah being one of those prophets. And one of the diverse ways that he spoke to prophets was by visions. And so Obadiah has a vision here, just like Ezekiel and others. Visions of God do not happen in this dispensation because God has chosen to reveal his word and inspire it and preserve it in a book. And so we have that in this dispensation, which is characteristic of the fact that we walk by faith and not by sight. Rather, in the Old Testament, where they did not have the completed revelation of God, God chose to speak to them in more visual, more physical ways. He would appear to them in signs and circumstances, of course, always making it clear that it was him. It wasn't just someone picking a circumstance saying that's God. They knew it was him. And in this case, a vision. And so Obadiah saw something. Okay, didn't necessarily understand it, but he saw it. We have the opposite, where we can understand the mysteries of God, even though we don't see God and we don't see visions and prophecies. Obadiah, rather, saw a vision, and so he writes down what he sees. He says, "Thus saith the Lord God concerning Edom," which we've covered in detail last week. Edom was Esau. "We have heard a rumor from the Lord." A rumor, as we mentioned at the end of last week, is not always a bad thing. We tend to use the word in our modern society, always referring to a negative thing. Don't spread rumors, that sort of thing. But a rumor is just a report. If a rumor is false, that would be a wrong thing. If a rumor is true, then, you know, then it's a true report, you see. And so here we have heard a rumor from the Lord. The Lord here has sent a report, a message, and it says in the next phrase, an ambassador is sent among the heathen. Now, it's interesting, this ambassador, this messenger sent from God, is sent to the nations. God did not send, did not give prophets to the nations, but here he's sending a messenger to the nations with this report. And the reason why he's sending them to the nations, to the heathen, is what it says there, not Israel, is that he wants them to rise up in battle against Edom, because this is a vision about Edom. He says, rise up in battle against her. Which should raise a question, which we ended last week with. Why is God gathering up a fight against Edom? Why is he just going to attack these people? Now, a lot of people come to the Old Testament books and they read them without starting from the beginning, without learning what happened first. And so by doing so, they have this question of why is God so angry? Why is he so mean? And they have this concept of God as if he's going to always hit people in the Old Testament. He's going to kill without cause. He's going to judge for every little thing. That is not the God of the Old Testament. We've covered before in our lessons in Romans that the God of love of the New Testament is the same God of love of the Old Testament. And so you can find place in the Old Testament where God has compassion on people, just like Jesus saw the multitudes and had compassion. And likewise, in Jesus' earthly ministry, you can see times where he's saying woe and destruction in the same tone as the God of the Old Testament says woe and destruction. There's always a reason. There's always a cause. And that's because God does not judge. He does not punish. He does not destroy for no reason. In fact, for no unrighteous reason, definitely. Okay, when God does destroy, when he does punish, when he does judge, it's always for a righteous cause. It's always, let me say it more specifically, it's for justice. It's not just for a righteous cause, it's for justice itself, okay? God is holy, and his holiness cannot be disturbed. And so when he has instructions and people disobey them, and they oppose him, and they resist him, then they face the consequences, okay? Now again, these consequences they face are not something that they don't know about. And we'll be studying this more tonight. Every time that God judges people in the Old Testament, he always gives them warning. He always sends messengers to say, stop doing this because God's going to come against you. Or he's not happy with you, that sort of thing. That's what the prophets were about. The prophets prophesied to people whom God had not yet judged and said, God's angry at you. So what would be the proper response of God-fearing people? Well, how can we get on his good side? You see, that would be the proper response. And yet what happens is when they hear these prophets, they kill them, they disregard them, they reject them. And so God gives them every opportunity to get on his good side, and they don't. In fact, in Romans, which we'll see here in a moment, God, in the Old Testament, we should be able to learn about God's long-suffering and goodness. And so many times people see the Old Testament as a picture of God's wrath and vengeance and that sort of thing, because that sticks out at them, because they don't see why he does that. So the point number one here this morning, as God sends, this evening, as God sends a messenger to the heathen saying, rise up and battle against Edom, is that God is not bloodthirsty. If you turn to Ezekiel in the Old Testament here, Ezekiel talks about God not having pleasure in the death of the wicked. Ezekiel 18, down at verse 20. I also have on your outline there a quote from Lamentations, which we'll hit here in a moment. But Ezekiel 18, this chapter is popular for God describing how he deals with individual sinners in the Old Testament. Very rarely do you see God dealing with revealing information about how he will save individual people, because he's dealing with a nation in prophecy in the Old Testament. And yet Ezekiel 18 talks about God's righteous judgment against people. In Ezekiel 18 verse 20, it says, the soul that sinneth, it shall die. The son shall not bear the iniquity of the father, neither shall the father bear the iniquity of the son. And so the case here is that just because your fathers were chosen of God, just because Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob God appeared to and gave them promises, and just because David's your father and he gave David the promise of sure mercies, does not mean you're exempt from judgment from God. Ezekiel 18 verse 20, they shall not bear the iniquity of the father, neither shall they inherit the righteousness of their father, which we'll go on to explain here. The righteousness of the wicked shall be upon him, and the wickedness of the wicked shall be upon him. And so if you're wicked, that's upon you. If you're righteous, that's upon you. You're judged on your own. You stand alone. Just like Paul says in Romans 14, we're all held accountable to God. Ezekiel 18 verse 21, if the wicked will turn from all his sins that he hath committed, and keep all my statutes, and do that which is lawful and right, he shall surely live. He shall not die. It says, verse 22, all his transgressions that he hath committed, they shall not be mentioned unto him. In his righteousness that he hath done, he shall live. Now notice, very obviously here in this verse, that this is very different than grace. Grace says it's not by works of righteousness which you have done, but by your faith in the finished work of Christ that righteousness is imputed to you. None of that is known back here in Ezekiel. Okay, they have no clue about this. God is trying to teach them, and they're operating under the law system, that God's trying to teach them the knowledge of their sin, of right and wrong. And he's teaching them a righteous judgment. And a righteous judgment is, I'm going to see what you do. You do right, then you get right. You do wrong, you get wrong. And so in verse 22 then, in his righteousness he shall live. In the same way Deuteronomy 6:25 under the law says, it shall be your righteousness if you do these commandments. Okay? It was the same for Gentile nations. Even though they didn't have 613 points of law to keep, all they had to do was bless Israel. If they blessed Israel and Israel's God, which is a lot fewer commandments than 613, they would be blessed. And what we're seeing is every time when God prophesies against a nation, it's always because they opposed God's people and they cursed Israel. And when they cursed Israel, Genesis 12:3 says, they'll get cursed of God. That's the reason. Okay? And so in Ezekiel 18:23, God says, have I any pleasure at all that the wicked should die? Rhetorical question. The answer of a righteous, loving, holy, peace-loving God is that no, he does not seek pleasure at the death of even the wicked. Now, he needs to justify things. He needs to have justice. He needs to balance the scales. He wouldn't be righteous at all if he let sin run rampant and not deal with it. That's not a righteous judge. And so God, in his holiness and his righteousness, has to keep that balance, keep that justice intact. And yet God is long-suffering. He does not want them to die, which is why he sends prophets, which is why he wrote all these pages in the Old Testament under the law program. He didn't want them to die. How long did God send people to Israel saying, repent, repent, turn, turn, repent, repent, change your mind, you'll do good? Because he wanted them not to die, you see. And so the people argue that the Old Testament, God's bloodthirsty and he's angry and he just likes to kill people indiscriminately. That's not true. Okay, the same God of love in the New Testament is in the Old Testament as well. And he shows his long suffering by how big these books are. Okay, how long God keeps sending people to them. So he has no pleasure at the wicked should die, saith the Lord, and not that he should return from his ways and live. God wants men to be saved. We know the mystery of God's will in 1 Timothy 2:4 is to see all men saved and come to a knowledge of the truth. That, by the way, has always been God's will. In time past, he wanted to do that on earth through his chosen nation, Israel. Okay, today he's doing that through you, the church, the body of Christ, who've been given the privilege of understanding the mysteries revealed to Paul. Okay, and so God has always wanted people to live. When he, when Joshua was leading the corrupt nation through the wilderness and back into the promised land, he told the nation of Israel, "I set you before you this day, life and death. Choose life, right? Don't choose death, right?" He says, "I know who my house is going to serve. We're going to serve the Lord, right?" And so there's a choice given to people whereby they can serve God or not. And under the Old Testament, God in his involvement in earthly things was very very present in the realities of the politics and the wars going on in the Old Testament surrounding Israel. And so when they rejected God, it's not like today, where in the dispensation of God's grace, he's not imputing sins unto men. Back under the law system, the law would condemn. And so God, even under the law, was long-suffering and gave them opportunity to choose life, even though they didn't. Look at Ezekiel 33, verse 11. Ezekiel 33 is a companion chapter, Ezekiel 18. And we have here again Ezekiel 33:11. God says, "As I live, saith the Lord God, I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but that the wicked turn from his way and live. Turn ye from your evil ways, for why will you die, O house of Israel?" And so here he's talking about Israel specifically, but he's describing him being the judge and him having this wicked man before him. And what he wants from this wicked man is to say, "I'm sorry, I shouldn't have done that, that's wrong, you're God, I'm not." And then God could justly reduce the sentence. And yet when you have someone blatantly opposing him and not repentant, not sorry, then what is a judge to do, okay, but to get rid of him? And so Ezekiel 33, Ezekiel 18 are chapters worthy of your consideration and study to realize God's patience and long-suffering and willingness that everyone should live, and that's why he sends the prophets. Okay, that's why he speaks in such stern language in the prophets, because they need to know that God was going to physically intervene and kill people based on their sins. Today, God's not doing that, okay? So we can't preach a prophet to someone and say, "God's going to strike you dead," because he won't today. He's not imputing sins today to people. Today, we're preaching God's grace and peace to the world. So it's very hard for us to get people to bow down to God out of fear. And that is a right thing for us today, by the way, because we are not preaching a gospel of fear. We're preaching a gospel of peace and God's grace. And so on one level, it's much harder for us to get people to turn to God, and yet we have a more powerful message that God has done everything for you by his grace, so that grace does move people to believe and have faith. But Lamentations chapter 3, verse 33 is another example in the Old Testament displaying God's mercy. Examples like this abound, by the way. Lamentations 3, 33. Chapter 3 of Lamentations is popular for the song, "Great is thy faithfulness," in verse 25, or 22 rather. "It is the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed, his compassions fail not." Lamentations is written by a prophet, Jeremiah, who's looking at the destroyed city of Jerusalem. So he's seeing God's punishment on the city, and he writes this book of Lamentations, laments, sorrow, crying. And in chapter 3, he says, you know what? Even though God has destroyed this city, he has not consumed the nation of Israel entirely. In fact, part of the nation was taken captive to Babylon. And so he finds comfort and solace in that, because God's compassions fail not. And so in the heart of tribulation, Jeremiah finds solace in God's compassion and in God's mercy. Lamentations 3:33 says, "He doth not afflict willingly, nor grieve the children of men." Back up in a verse, in verse 31 and 32, it says, "The Lord will not cast off forever, but though he cause grief, yet will he have compassion according to the multitude of his mercies. For he," again, "he doth not afflict willingly, nor grieve the children of men." God is not quick to kill. He is not quick to destroy. Okay, he is long-suffering towards sin, and that's the God that we serve. Okay, so this idea in the Old Testament that God is quick trigger to kill somebody is not what the Old Testament describes of him. Okay, and so don't let folks get away with that and describing God that way, because he's not. You look at Romans chapter 2, in verse 2. We studied this out back in chapter 2 in our Romans study, how Paul was dealing with Israel in chapter 2. And he's talking about those who are in a position to judge other people. And he says, he's bringing to light the fact that they've got sin in their lives as well. In Romans 2:2, he says, "We are sure that the judgment of God is according to truth against them which commit such things." Every time God describes his judgment or promises to judge somebody based on their actions against him, we can be sure that his judgment is according to truth. Abraham asked, wouldn't the judge of all the earth do right back in Genesis? And that's something we do well to remember, okay? When we don't even understand why things happen in the Old Testament the way they do, why did God do that? Why did he send Israel over here? Why did he destroy all those people in the Red Sea and that sort of thing? When we don't yet understand all those things, we need to study some more. But we need to remember that the judge of all the earth will do right. We serve a righteous God. We serve a just God, okay? It's Romans 2:2. God will not condemn people unjustly. It won't happen. And so the accusation against God that he's going to send people to hell unjustly is not an accurate description of the God that we serve. Okay, so we need to change our thinking about that. Romans 2 verse 3 says, "Thinkest thou this, O man, that judgest them which do such things, and doest the same, that thou shalt escape the judgment of God?" So there are a lot of people who think that God is wrong to judge because they don't have a proper view of sin. And that's typically the problem. When people are against God's judgment and what he says is wrong, because they don't understand right and wrong. They've been seared in their conscience against what's wrong. And they tend to justify their own sins. That's what Romans 2 is dealing with. So in verse 4 it says, "Or despisest thou the riches of his goodness and forbearance and longsuffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leads thee to repentance?" And so verse 4 teaches us that even in the Old Testament or Israel's program, that God displayed his goodness and forbearance and longsuffering. He does not say, looking back in the Old Testament, we learn about God's anger and God's vengeance, even though we can read passages about it. What we learn about that time is that God was long-suffering and forbearing. Because as the prophets were preaching this, they kept preaching it and kept preaching it, and God was long to the extent that some people said, you know what, you keep preaching this, but God's never going to judge. Which is the same thing some people say today. They say, God's never going to return. He's never going to come back and judge. And they do that to justify their own sins. I had someone email me the other day and said that very thing. He says, well, you know, if God's going to send me to hell, why don't I just do more sins? Why don't I just try to get as many sins as I can in this life? He's going to send me to hell. What a wrong view, okay? What a wrong perspective that doing sin at all is a right thing, okay? We need to have the perspective that even though we understand that we're sinners, that God is right, even if we're wrong, okay? And so even if my judgment was guilty, you know what? God should be right. You know, the righteous should reign. That's what we should understand. But in fact, sinners think the exact opposite. They think, to be fair, we should take all the wicked people and set them on the same stage as all the righteous people. Even if we can agree that everybody is unrighteous, shouldn't we all agree to let the righteous rule? Let them reign? Let them have the best of things? Isn't that a right judgment? Okay? And so, meanwhile, the Bible teaches us these things, and it only comes from reading it. Back in Psalms 25, we see another example here of God's mercy. The Psalms display a lot of God's mercy back here. Psalm 117, 118, these are whole chapters dedicated to God's mercy in the Old Testament. Psalm 25, verse 7. "Remember not the sins of my youth, nor my transgressions. According to thy mercy, remember thou me for thy goodness' sake, O Lord." So here's the psalmist, David, asking God not to remember his sins and to remember him for his goodness, for God's goodness' sake. Okay, so why should God remember David? Why should he account any of us? Well, in the Old Testament, they didn't know why. They didn't have the knowledge of the cross or the God's grace or his blood shed for us. All they could plead for was, God, you're merciful, you're good, you're right, for your goodness' sake, show mercy on me, is all they can proclaim. And they trusted in that, knowing that God was merciful. Okay? Ask a Jew today how he knows his sins are forgiven. And of course, they don't have the same assurance as you do under grace, because we know that it's completed with Christ's blood on the cross. But they say, because God is merciful. We serve a merciful God. Why won't he forget our sins when we ask or confess? He's merciful. He's good. He can't not be merciful. As long as we come to him in a contrite heart, in an honest, genuine repentance, as they would say. Okay? Doesn't that sound a lot like religious Christianity today? Ignorant of the mystery of Christ, ignorant of God's grace. So Psalm 25:7, this is what David's praying here. In verse 8, it says, good and upright is the Lord. Okay, Psalms describe a lot about God. And we can learn a lot about who God is from the Psalms. What we can't learn is what God is doing today in the Psalms. Okay, but it says, good and upright is the Lord. Okay, so when people think that God is not good to judge or is not honest in his judgment, upright, they're blaspheming. They're speaking against the scripture. Psalm 25, verse 8. Therefore will he teach sinners in the way. Psalm 25, 8, David talking about himself, says, since God is good, he'll teach sinners. You know what good people do? You know what upright judges do? They try to help those who can't help themselves, right? And so David's counting on this for God to give him forgiveness, him salvation. He's saying, you're good, you're honest, you're upright, you're merciful, you teach sinners the right way, teach me, he says. You know, help me along the way. Verse 9, the meek will he guide in judgment, the meek will he teach his way. All the paths of the Lord are mercy and truth unto such as keep his covenant and his testimonies. For thy name's sake, O Lord, pardon mine iniquity, for it is great. Okay, this is the proper response of a man of faith. Habakkuk and Romans chapter 1 both say the just shall live by faith, right? Faith in God, depending on him, not themselves, realizing that they need God, his goodness, his mercy, that he is the good that they need in their lives. Okay, so Psalm 25 verse 10 says this, the paths of the Lord are mercy and truth. Verse 11, for God's sake, for his name's sake, he's going to pardon our iniquities. Okay, now we know something even greater about the wisdom of God and how he could do that and still maintain his righteousness. And we learn that in Romans. But you see here in Psalm 25 how merciful God is, how good he is, how honest he is, even in the Old Testament. So we come back to Obadiah, and we read here about God sending a messenger to the heathen and saying, let's rise up in battle against the Edomites, and we're going to destroy these people. We should ask the question, why is he doing this? There's a contradiction, is there not? Just like we learned on Sunday, that there are many contradictory verses in your Bible. We read that God is good and upright and helps the sinners. Then we read in Obadiah, he's promising to kill them. Well, something happened there, okay? Edom and Esau wasn't born for God to kill. Okay, something happened where God changed his judgment from being that mercy to them finally deserving his wrath. Okay, and we're going to learn more about that next week. Look at Matthew 25. Matthew 25, verse 31. There is a judgment that all men will face. Hebrews 9 says it's destined for man to die and then to face the judgment. Okay, every man will be judged of God, even us who are saved by God's grace. We have a position that cannot be taken away from us in the heavenlies, and we're members of the body of Christ, but we'll still see the head of the body be judged by the sort of work we do. So none of us will escape God's judgment. Thank God that Jesus Christ is in our place, so that when God sees us, he doesn't judge us for our sins, because Jesus Christ took the judgment for our sins on the cross. Okay, and that's the message of God's grace. But in Matthew 25, it describes one of the many judgments God will perform against humanity. And Matthew 25, 31 specifically starts talking about a judgment of the nations. Something made the news just recently, and it's been in our society for quite a while, has been Matthew 25 ministries. Okay, and there's Matthew 25 ministries who seek to help the least of these in society. And by helping the poor, feeding the hungry, clothing the naked, they get from Matthew 25 that they will pass and get gold stars at this judgment. Okay, the problem is, this is not the judgment they need to be concerned about. And this is the kingdom judgment, and this is a national judgment. They're not at all preaching the cross for salvation, which means they're not putting their faith in the cross. They're putting their faith in how many cups of water they gave to the thirsty. Okay, that's a problem. And so Matthew 25, 31, read here, where Jesus says that the Son of Man shall come in his glory, when the Son of Man shall come in his glory, and all the holy angels with him, then shall he sit upon the throne of his glory. So already we get a context. Jesus is talking about his return to the earth in his kingdom, sitting on his throne on the earth. Jesus in the red letters came preaching the kingdom to Israel, because that's what we expect to find here. In verse 32, it says, and before him shall be gathered all nations, and he shall separate them one from another, as a shepherd divides his sheep from the goats, and he shall set the sheep on his right hand, but the goats on his left. Now, in these two verses, what are the sheep and what are the goats? Nations. Okay, there's nations in front of him, and he separates the sheep nations from the goat nations. The sheep nations, of course, are the ones that follow him, right? Sheep know the shepherd. And the goat nations are the ones that would rebel, but, you know, they go away from him, okay? And we're going to see that later in the chapter. But Matthew 25:33 is a national judgment. Now, where in the Bible does God lay any basis, any criteria for a national judgment? Remember Genesis 12, verse 3? I'm creating a nation with you, Abraham. You'll have a seed, and whomever blesses you will be blessed. Whoever curses you will be cursed. This is the judgment God gives out in a very physical way in the kingdom. He comes back, sets up his throne, and he looks around the nation and said, all right, who blessed my people? Who blessed these least of these of my brethren, Israelites? And whoever didn't, curse. Whomever didn't, they get judged. Okay, they don't get the blessing in the kingdom. So that's what Matthew 25:31 is dealing with here. And I bring this up because this is what's going on back in Obadiah. Okay? God is talking about a curse against the Edomites, against a nation, just like here. So Matthew 25:34, then shall the king say unto them on his right hand, those would be the sheep, nations, come ye blessed of my father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungered, and ye gave me meat. I was thirsty, ye gave me drink. I was a stranger, ye took me in. Just like Israel wandering through the wilderness there. And when they wandered through that wilderness, we talked last week, they came through here and they're trying to get into that promised land. And if those nations blessed them and gave them food to eat and things to drink, they entered the promised land and those nations would be blessed of God. Okay? If Israel wandering through the wilderness here was trying to get to their promised land and the nations forbade their presence, fought against them, did not give them food, resisted them, tried to kill them, that wouldn't bode well at the judgment of the sheep and goats. Okay, and that's what we're going to see next week with Edom and what they did when Israel very literally went through the wilderness there, and they forced them to go around the whole nation, and later they tried to fight them. Okay, it's problematic for them according to the promise God gave to Abraham. Okay, so in verse 34, 35, and 36, it talks about what they could do to bless Israel. Verse 41. Then shall he say also unto them on his left hand, depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting fire, prepared for the devil. Did I miss a verse here? Yeah, no, 41 is what I want. Then shall he say also unto them on the left hand, depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. Which has a lot of teaching in it that we can go into. Hell was not created for men. God does not want us to go there. It was created for the devil and his angels. Who could not be born again in Israel's system. And so verse 42 says, I was hungered and you gave me no meat. I was thirsty, you gave me no drink. I was a stranger, you took me not in, and so on and so forth. And so they will, verse 46, be cast away into everlasting judgment, and the righteous will have life eternal. This is the judgment of the nations that Christ the King will dish out, will give out, will sentence when he returns in his kingdom and throne, and he'll make that judgment, okay? And that is an explanation of the judgments we read about back in Jeremiah and Isaiah and Ezekiel and Obadiah about these nations and whether they blessed Israel or not. The brethren of Jesus, the least of those, Matthew 25, is not the poor among you. It was those that God blessed, which is the nation of Israel. It was his chosen nation, okay? So just some context there. Look back at Jeremiah 25. We see that there's a righteous judgment from God that's going to happen. We see in Matthew 25, based on the promise he gave to Abraham, that there's a judgment of nations. And we're going to see again here in Jeremiah 25 that God's judgment was not capricious. It had a standard, a criteria. Jeremiah 25, and this whole chapter is really worth your study. But here's Jeremiah prophesying against the nations. And again, these are nations that would not be those blessing Israel. Okay? And so, if you want to know what it's like for nations, the Old Testament not blessing Israel, these verses tonight are the ones we're talking about. There were nations that did bless Israel, and they received blessing from God as well. Those would be the sheep nations. So, in Jeremiah 25, we'll start down in verse 14. Oh, we'll start verse 15, rather. Well, thus saith the Lord God of Israel unto me, take the wine cup of this fury at mine hand, and cause all the nations to whom I send thee to drink it, There's a cup of fury, a cup of wrath. And verse 16 says, they shall drink and be moved and be mad because of the sword that I will send among them. Then took I the cup of the Lord's hand and made all the nations to drink unto whom the Lord had sent me, to wit, Jerusalem and the cities of Judah and the kings thereof and the princes thereof, to make them a desolation, an astonishment, a hissing, a curse, as it is this day. He starts listing these nations that are supposed to drink of the wrath of God, the cup of the wrath of God. And the first on the list is who? Jerusalem, his own people. Okay. God in his prophecy has declared that he will judge the world. And in Israel's program, the first to be judged was Israel. You read about that in Isaiah 3 and 4 and 2 Peter, where Peter says, if we're going to be judged, what is it that starts first in his own house? Okay, and so God's going to judge his people, and whoever survives that judgment of fire will be purified, and his remnant, his believers, will come out of that. But he also is going to cast this judgment, pour out this cup of fury on the nations as well, not just Israel. And so it goes on in verse 19 to say, Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and his servants, and his princes, and all his people, and all the mingled people, and all the kings in the land of Uz, that's where Job came from, right? And all the kings in the land of the Philistines, and Ashkelon, and Azah, and Ekron, and the remnant of Ashdod, Edom, Moab, and the children of Ammon. Those are the nations we see here, Edom, Moab, Ammon, on our map. And all the kings of Tyrus, the kings of Sidon, the kings of the isles which are beyond the sea. And it goes on to list all of these kings. Drop down to verse 27. Therefore, thou shalt say unto them, thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, drink ye and be drunken, and spew and fall, and rise no more, because of the sword which I will send among you. And it shall be, if they refuse to take the cup of thine at thine hand to drink, then shalt thou say unto them, thus saith the Lord of hosts, ye shall certainly drink. So you're going to force this cup on them. And verse 29, for lo, I began to bring evil on the city which is called by my name, and should ye be utterly unpunished? If God's going to come back and judge his own people, should he not judge the nations also? And so he says, you shall not be unpunished, for I will call for a sword upon all the inhabitants of the earth, saith the Lord of hosts. Therefore prophesy against them all these words, and say unto them, the Lord shall roar from on high, and utter his voice from his holy habitation, and he shall mightily roar upon his habitation. He shall give a shout as they that tread the grapes against all the inhabitants of the earth. So it's talking about the Lord's return here, and his return in judgment. He'll come and he'll judge his people. He'll come and judge the nations. He'll set up his kingdom. And we read about that judgment in Matthew 25 and Jeremiah 25 as well. And so God will judge the nations, and it's not just because they exist. It's for the works that they do, for or against God and God's people specifically. Back in Jeremiah 25, 14, the verse I skipped over says, for many nations and great kings shall serve themselves of them also, and I will recompense them according to their deeds, according to the works of their own hands. And so this judgment's coming as a result of their works. If they would bless God's nation, if they would be thankful to God, as Romans 1 describes, if they would glorify God as God, there's no fear at this judgment here. Okay? And yet the truth is that since the beginning of the world, Romans chapter 1 describes, people have not glorified God as God. They haven't been thankful to him. They have not come to him through his chosen people. They have rejected God and opposed him all along the way. And as a result of that, judgment will come. Okay, and so this has been the same message from the beginning that we all preach. Back to Obadiah, finally. Let's get back to Obadiah and see what he's saying here. So with all this introduction into God's judgment, why he gives judgment, when he's giving judgment, and how he's giving judgment to the nations, Obadiah, verse 1, he's calling to the heathens and says, rise against Edom in battle. Rise up against her in battle. Behold, I have made thee small among the heathen. For thou art greatly despised. And so Edom, who we saw last week, was a nation created before Israel, and they were a nation growing in influence and power. God has made them small among the nations now because they're greatly despised. What's going on is God is going to bring them low. Okay, they set themselves up. They've set themselves as an authority. When Israel came to Edom through the wilderness, Edom was more powerful than Israel. Okay, as far as the numbers, as far as the influence and the authority. Of course, God was with Israel, and that was the difference. Okay, and so God says here, I've made thee small among the heathen compared to me. Right, thou art greatly despised. Despised in their rulership, despised in who they are. Even though they wanted to be the foremost nation, like every nation today wants to be, they're greatly despised, because the way they achieved this power, and we'll read about this next week as well, is not through righteousness. It's not through a holy way. Back in Proverbs, it describes that there are two ways that rulers get control over people, and there is a righteous way and an unrighteous way. Okay, and we've all experienced one or the other or both in our lifetimes. Proverbs 29 verse 2 says, when the righteous are in authority, the people rejoice, but when the wicked bears rule, the people mourn. Okay, when there's an unrighteous ruler, when someone usurps power deceptively and doesn't do it according to righteous means, the subjects don't like it. Okay, we've seen this throughout history. But when there's a righteous ruler, a righteous king, there's no worry of being subject to this guy. Okay, Edom here apparently is being despised because of their unrighteous dealings, their betrayals, their confederacies, the conspiracies against Israel, against God. Their sins has caused them to have power, but in an unrighteous way. Okay, and so they're causing problems, and they're greatly despised here. And so what God is doing in the case of Edom here, when he's calling the nations against her, what he is quite literally doing is creating a revolution against an unrighteous rule. He is enforcing justice. Just a few years ago, people celebrated the Arab Springs, right, where the people revolted. In America, we celebrate our own revolution, where we cast off the bonds of England and that sort of thing. And very rarely is someone against one of these types of revolutions throwing off oppression, all right? Because they declare their the tyrannies of their rulers, they throw off the chains of bondage, and yay, everyone's free and happy and peaceful, right? This is what's going on here. They're despised in their authority and their leadership, and what God is doing here is destroying their power. And how is he doing that? By causing other nations to come against them, the heathen to come against them, is going to destroy them, okay? So if they had gotten this position by right, if they had gotten this position by a right means, there would not have been this problem, okay? If they had gotten here by blessing God's people instead of cursing them, there wouldn't have been this problem, you see. But they were greatly despised, verse 2 says. And so God here is seeking true justice. Again, I'm trying to paint this picture, present the perspective from God's viewpoint that he is dealing justice here. Okay, it is not from the Edomites where, hey, we finally made it, we're a nation, because they got there through corruption. They got there through cursing God. That's not the way you get there. Okay, and so they're greatly despised in verse 2. Verse 3 says, the pride of thine heart hath deceived thee, thou that dwellest in the clefts of the rock, whose habitation is high, that saith in his heart, who shall bring me down to the ground? And so in verse 3, we see the truth of Proverbs 16:18, where pride comes before the fall, right? And which I actually misquoted there. In Proverbs 6, we know pride was one of the things that God hates. And we know a heart that, Proverbs 6 verse, or 16:18 rather. Pride goeth before destruction, a haughty spirit before a fall. I wanted to make sure to read that because people misquote that. Just like I just did. It's not pride goes before a fall. It's pride goes before destruction and a haughty spirit before a fall. And that's what's going on, not only in Edom here, but in every nation that rejects God, okay? In every person that rejects God. The reason why they do it is because of pride. Because they think themselves higher than what they are. They think, I don't need God. I don't need the life that he gives. I don't need the earth that he created for us. I don't need the salvation he offers. I can do it on my own. And in this rebelliousness, God says, fine, you don't want it. You're not going to get it. And they get judgment. They get death. And they get destruction. Okay. Obadiah 3, this is what's happening in Edom here. Again, the pride of thine heart hath deceived thee. They think they've made it. And yet they think they've conquered their enemy, Israel. And yet their pride has deceived them. That's what God says. And so it says, thou that dwellest in the clefts of the rock. The clefts of the rock there references where Edom was at. I drew mountains last week, and I explained a little bit that the Edom was in a place, a mountainous country. It wasn't a green country of plains and grass. It was a mountainous country where now you may have heard of the town, the town Petra, where you've seen pictures of the giant cliffs and they've carved the city into the stones. Remember the movie Indiana Jones, where they went into the stone city there? And that's what made it famous. But that comes from this place in Edom, okay, where they built the cities in the mountains, and they prided themselves in that, because mountains is where people went to protect themselves from their enemies when they used to fight wars with, you know, chariots and bow and arrows and fist fights and that sort of thing. You'd go to a place where they couldn't get you, you know, high places, mountains. All right. Now we're shooting rockets and everything else and airplanes. That doesn't really help too much. But they're hiding in the mountains in Obadiah verse 3, and not just hiding there, but they're ruling from there. Okay. And so thou dwellest in the clefts of the rock, and that gives them their security, that they're in the mountain, that they have this secure fortress of stone, a natural fortress. And yet God says this is a deception. You think you're safe, you think you're secure, and yet you're not. Okay, and he's hinting at the fact that they're under God's disapproval here. Okay, so then the clefts of the rock, which deals with their location. It's also interesting that we'll get here in a little bit that the clefts of the rock is where people go to hide from God's judgment in Revelation. Remember, like Revelation 6, when God's judgment starts to be poured out and the people go hide in the caves, people think they can get security through the strongest thing on the planet, which are rocks, okay, and yet they can't. Okay, God sees the secret places. He sees where you're hiding. He sees the depths of your heart and your mind. And so the clefts of the rock are not a guard, not a defense against righteousness, against God. Okay, and so Edom and their inhabitants dwell in the clefts of the rock. Their habitation is high, which again is speaking where they're at geographically, but also in their heart. They think of themselves as higher than the need to submit to God, which is why they're rejecting his people. And so they say in their heart, who shall bring me down to the ground? Now, when it says their habitation is high, that kind of reminded me, and should remind you, of Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12, where we battle today against those in high places, but it's not those who are in the mountains, okay? There's spiritual wickedness in high places. It's talking about principalities and powers and places and heavenly places in the darkness, okay? So we're fighting invisible principalities and powers that are in high places. Here, the Edomites were in literal earthly high places, okay? This is the battle many people fight today. Earthly dominion, earthly kingdoms, those in high places and seats and thrones on the earth, that's not our battle. We're not battling flesh and blood. God here is battling flesh and blood. I mean, see the difference. Okay, Ephesians 6, verse 12, when Paul says we battle not against flesh and blood, but against the principalities and powers and authorities and spiritual wickedness in high places. Obadiah 1, 3, God is fighting flesh and blood, people. All right? We have a different orientation against battling with the Lord today. Here he's calling people to physically battle against other flesh and blood people. Today, we don't have that call. We're not calling flesh and blood to battle against flesh and blood. We're calling people to the gospel of peace, the gospel of the grace of God, okay? But the Edomites here are asking the question in their heart, who shall bring me down to the ground? We're so high, we have so much authority, so much power, who will bring us down? And of course, this has been the hubris of every great empire in history, every great nation in history, is that they get to a point where they think, hey, we're so great, nobody can defeat us, and all of a sudden they go down. And so the proverb bears out in history. But they're asking, who shall bring me down to the ground? The answer will be God. He's going to describe how he's going to destroy them and bring them down. Isaiah 2 describes how God, when he comes back and sets up his kingdom on Mount Zion, he will take the high places and make them low, and the low places and make them high. And so Israel, who has been condemned and despised throughout history, will be made the highest nation. And those nations who have ruled over Israel, those who have oppressed Israel, will be made low and be the lowest nation. Which should give you some insight to Jesus' teaching in Matthew that if you want to be first, you need to be last. If you want to be last, you need to be first. Right? He's dealing there with the same Abrahamic promise of blessing and cursing to his people that he's dealing with Obadiah with. Okay? So back to Obadiah verse 4. It says, though thou exalt thyself as the eagle, and though thou set thy nest among the stars, thence will I bring thee down, saith the Lord. You think you're so high? You think the clefts of the rock are protecting you? I'm going to bring you down from those clefts. I'm going to bring you down. You think you're like an eagle that flies high above everyone else and is protected from everyone. I'm going to shoot you down, is what he says. Your nest is up there in the mountains. It says, thy nest is among the stars. says, thence will I bring them down. Now, an eagle in the Bible, of course, is always a sign of superior strength. Eagles in the Bible are those who nest in high places so no one can disturb them, as opposed to those birds that nest down low where animals can eat their eggs and that sort of thing. Eagles also are very strong. They're swift when they attack. They're around the dead things. In the Bible, eagles also refer to vultures and that sort of thing that eat up dead things. And so they're the ones that have that sort of control. And so God refers to himself as an eagle when he comes back in judgment against Edom. He says that he bore Israel on eagle's wings. Remember that? And what does that mean? Well, eagle flies high. You know, so here's Israel. They're being oppressed by Egypt. He bears them on eagle's wings and gets them out of there. You know, he saves them. You know, he puts them on their wings and flies away. You know, he delivers them. And so here, Edom thinks they're like an eagle. They think their nest is among the stars. There's no way anybody can bring us down. And God says, I will bring thee down, saith the Lord. So God can and he will. Back in Proverbs and Job, I left some verses there for your reference, how eagles are described as those in the heavens, as those who fly up in the sky. This was before the Wright brothers and all that. So figuring out the way of the eagle was something that is a wonderful thing. And just in the last century, we've figured something out. And even then, even though we've got these airplanes, we still can't do the things birds can, which is quite fascinating. We stick a metal tube in the air with two flaps out the end, and then we think that's a bird. And you see things birds do. That's amazing. The way they land, the way they take off, the way they turn in midair, and that sort of thing. So Proverbs 30:19 is correct when it says there are three things that are wonderful that we can't know, and that's the way of the bird and the sky, the way the eagle in the sky. So it's fascinating. But Obadiah verse 4, Edom thinks they're an eagle that cannot be touched. Okay, their nest is among the stars, which I don't want to give you too much speculation here, but again, that should remind us of someone else who tries to make their nest among the stars and says, I'm higher than the stars, and you won't bring me down. You may remember Satan saying that in Isaiah 14, and Lucifer saying that. Over in Isaiah chapter 14, it describes Satan's agenda, or at least his thoughts against God, in a prophecy about an earthly king of Babylon who thought himself to be like Lucifer. Isaiah 14, verse 12 says, how art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nations? Thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven, I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. And of course, we know stars of God are not just the stars in the sky. They're angels. Okay, they're authorities in heaven. And so the stars of God, they think we're going to exalt our throne up there. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation, the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. So these are people who are saying, you know, God exists. He's there. But Lucifer says, I'm going to be like him. And I'm going to be right there with him. It'll be like God 1, God 2. There I am. Well, first commandment, there's only one God. There's no other God but him, and he's above all things. Okay, so that is the sin of man, the first sin of man, the first sin of the devil, is that we can be like God. That we don't need him, we don't need to thank him. Now that we can breathe, we can do it on our own. You can't, okay? We need God to live, we need God to have everlasting life. We need God for nothing more than the fact that he is goodness. And so if we're going to be good, if we're going to be holy, we're infringing on his copyright, okay? That's who he is. And so we copy ourselves after him. Meanwhile, Obadiah, verse 4, has a reference there to them being among the stars, and God's going to bring them down. Could be an allusion to God bringing down all those high places, including the devil, okay? Over in Revelation, when he comes down from heaven and he brings down those authorities, those evil authorities, and he casts down those authorities on the earth. In verse 5, it says, if thieves come to thee, if robbers by night, how art thou cut off? Would they not have stolen till they had enough? If the grape gatherers came to thee, would they not leave some grapes? How are the things of Esau searched out? How are his hid things sought up? So he describes here, you know, if thieves and robbers come to you at night, and then he kind of relishes in the fact that if they're coming to you at night, they're going to destroy you anyway, which is a justice thing. But he says, if they come, would they not have stolen till they had enough, and then they'd leave some things there? If grape gatherers came to thee, wouldn't they not leave some grapes? You know, that they wouldn't take all the grapes, they would leave some. You know, there'd be some left behind. Thieves don't take everything you own. And yet God says, I will search out the hidden things of Esau and take them. I will destroy everything. Okay? And we're going to see next week the reason why he gives this curse. It's because this is exactly what Edom did to Israel. When they were down, Edom beat them some more. Okay? And so it wasn't that they showed any mercy to Israel. In the same way, God's not going to show any mercy to them. Okay? And so when it says here the thing about the thieves and about the grape gatherers, this is dealing with God's judgment on Edom. In let's look at Jeremiah 49. We'll get some more hint at this. Jeremiah chapter 49. I told you last week that there are 5 or 6 verses in Obadiah quoted in Jeremiah 49, which also has a prophecy against Edom. Okay. So in Jeremiah 49, we're going to drop down to verse 7, where it says, "Concerning Edom, thus saith the Lord of hosts, is wisdom no more in Teman?" You may recall, if you studied Job recently, that Eliphaz, one of the three wise friends of Job, was a Temanite. He was from the land of Edom. Job was from the land of Uz, which is near Edom over here. And so Jeremiah is saying, is there no more wisdom in Teman? Is counsel perished from the prudent? Is their wisdom vanished? Edom was considered a nation of wise people at one point. Not necessarily wise for God, but wise in the world. He says, "Flee ye, turn back, dwell deep, O inhabitants of Dedan, for I will bring the calamity of Esau upon him, the time that I will visit him. If grape gatherers come to thee, would they not have some gleaning grapes?" Gleaning grapes, grapes they leave behind for the gleaners. "If thieves by night, they will destroy till they have enough, and then they'll leave," right? When they have enough, they'll leave some. "But I have made Esau bare. I have uncovered his secret places, and he shall not be able to hide himself. His seed is spoiled. His brethren is neighbors, and he is not. Leave thy fatherless children, I will preserve them alive, and let thy widows trust in me. For thus saith the Lord, behold, they whose judgment was not to drink of the cup have assuredly drunken. And art thou he that shalt together go unpunished? Thou shalt not go unpunished, but thou shalt surely drink of it." And so he says in verse 13, "I have sworn by myself, saith the Lord, that Bozra," which was the capital of Edom, "shall become a desolation, a reproach, a waste, and a curse, and all the cities thereof shall be perpetual wastes." And then in verse 14, he begins Obadiah verse 1. "I've heard a rumor from the Lord, an ambassador sent among the heathen." He starts quoting Obadiah. He's talking about the curse of Edom, and you notice what he said there about the grape gatherers and the thieves. They leave things behind. I mean, you get hit by a thief, it's a bad thing, but you know, you still got your nest egg, you still got things in your mattress. God's not going to leave anything behind for Esau. He's going to lay it bare. And in fact, a lot of people point to a fulfillment, at least a partial fulfillment of this prophecy today when you look at the land where the Edomites were at, such a mighty people, and there's nothing there. That city of Petra that Indiana Jones was searching through, there's nobody there. It's dust, and there's, you know, wild animals living there, so there's nothing there. And so it's amazing how some of these things happen, and a lot of these nations in the Old Testament aren't there, and yet, you know, there are still a people that claim to be Israel around. All right, and so you have that type of thing people promote. But back in Jeremiah 49, in verse 14 through 22, we see Jeremiah repeats Obadiah here. And down in verse 22 in Jeremiah 49, it says, "Behold, he shall come up and fly as the eagle and spread his wings over Bozra. And at that day shall the heart of the mighty men of Edom be as the heart of a woman in her pangs." And so screams of childbirth, right? Screaming like a woman here. And so that's what's going to happen when God comes to judge Edom. It also says in verse 21, the noise will be like the noise heard in the Red Sea when God destroyed the army of the Egyptians. There's no more. There's nothing left. Okay? And so that's the idea in Obadiah. Look back to Obadiah verse 6. Move on down here through the passage, 6 and 7. "The secret things of Esau are searched out, his hidden things are sought up, and of course destroyed and taken, as we saw in Jeremiah 49. Verse 7 says, "All the men of thy confederacy have brought thee even to the border. The men that were at peace with thee have deceived thee and prevailed against thee. They that eat thy bread have laid a wound under thee," which is a quote of the Psalms. It says, "There is none understanding in him." And so in verse 7 it says there's a confederacy of people, there's your allies, there's a group of nations that Edom dealt with in confederacy against Israel, against the smaller nations, and God says, these, your confederate nations, they're going to hurt you, they're going to turn on you, they're going to deceive you. So you think you're the one, you're the leader bringing these people together, you're going to be the one destroyed. okay? And they're going to cause you trouble. And so those that eat thy bread, you know, they're in your house, planning with you, eating your bread, your friends, your allies, they're going to turn against you. There's no understanding in them, okay, in him. And so if you look at Psalm 83 quickly, you'll see Psalm 83 describes the names of these confederate nations, okay? And we'll get more into this next week as well. Psalm 83 says, "Keep not thou silence, O God, hold not thy peace, be not still, O God. For lo, thine enemies make a tumult, and they that hate thee have lift up the head. They have taken crafty counsel against thy people, and consulted against thy hidden ones. They have said, Come, and let us cut them off from being a nation, and the name of Israel may be no more in remembrance." So you see here a phrase that is so often in our discussions and the headlines even today, where there are nations calling for the destruction of Israel and that sort of thing. Not knowing that they have no spiritual standing with God in this dispensation, but Psalm 83 verse 4, there are people back then who are saying, "Come and let us cut them off from being a nation," and that's because the imaginations, as it's been said before, the imaginations of wicked people, the imaginations of sinful people, are satanically inspired. Okay, and by that I mean Satan had a plan to lift himself up like God. Satan has a plan to be against God's purposes, and Israel is God's name, is God's people. And Satan will be against that, which means that unsaved humanity, those who rebel against God, will be against God's purposes. So in Psalm 83, verse 4, they were against his nation. They did not want to have remembrance of it. Verse 5 says, "For they have consulted together with one consent." That's confederacy. They came together, they consented, and they are confederate against thee, God. The tabernacles of, here's the names, tabernacles of Edom, number one on the list. Ishmaelites, which we covered last week from Ishmael Hagar, the Moabites, which are Lot's daughter's bastard children, right? The Hagarines from Hagar, Gebal and Ammon. Ammon was one of Lot's children. The Amalekites, the Philistines, with the inhabitants of Tyre, and so on and so forth. It says in verse 9, "Do unto them as unto the Midianites, as to Sisera, as to Jabin," at the brook of Kishon. He says, "Do unto them as to all the enemies you destroyed before." Remember the story of Jabin and Sisera. Sisera, as we may recall, where they were captive to Jabin, okay, the king, and then God rose up Deborah, the woman judge there, and delivered Israel from them. And Sisera, the chief military leader there, came and ran and hid to the wife of one of the chief military officers in Israel. And her name was Jael. Remember that? So Sisera lays down, and Jael gives him some milk and says, "I'll hide you from the soldiers." And when he lays down to go to sleep, Jael drives a stake through his head. And so Psalm 83 says, treat them like Sisera. Treat them like Jabin. Destroy them. You know, stop them. And so David here, or Asaph rather, is bringing to recollection what God did to deliver Israel in time past. It says, do the same to these people because they're confederate against you. Okay, they've conspired against us, and they've taken our things. Look at Psalm 137. You'll see another psalm about Edom specifically and their treachery against God's people. Now again, remember, this is what makes these statements different than any other nation is that God hath not dealt with any nation like he has with Israel. Okay, these are God's people. God was with them. So when they attacked Israel, they were attacking God himself and what he was doing. Psalm 137, verse 7. "Remember, O Lord, the children of Edom in the day of Jerusalem." In the day of Jerusalem's destruction, that is, when Jeremiah was writing about their destruction, the Edomites conspired to help Nebuchadnezzar destroy them. He says, "Remember the children of Edom who said, raise it, even to the foundation thereof." And so when Nebuchadnezzar came and destroyed the city, tore down the walls of Jerusalem, and obviously they had won the battle, here are the Edomites saying, destroy everything. Not one stone upon another, right? Raise it, raise it. Let's destroy the whole thing. And so they kept pushing, having no mercy against the Israelites, to the extent of even taking their children and killing their children against the stones and that sort of thing, which is why verse 9 says, "Happy shall he be that taketh and dasheth thy little ones against the stones," because that would be eye for an eye, right? That would be what the Edomites did to Israel. And so what a shameful thing that they did to God's people, deserving God's judgment here. So back to Obadiah, verse 7 and 8. Obadiah says, "Shall I not in that day, saith the Lord, even destroy the wise men out of Edom and understanding out of the Mount of Esau?" Because of, we've already read so many things that they've done already, but we'll learn more next week about that. And thy mighty men, O Teman, shall be dismayed to the end, that every one of the mount of Esau may be cut off by slaughter. And so because of their pride, because of their confederacy, because of what they're doing here to Israel, God gives a curse to them. And he says that every one of the mount of Esau may be cut off by slaughter. Okay, they're going to be destroyed. And the next verse there will lead us into next week. And where it says, for thy violence against thy brother Jacob, shame shall cover thee, and thou shalt be cut off forever. Okay. There's a reason why God gives judgment in the Old Testament. There's a reason why God has so much to say in prophecy against Edom, and why Malachi 1 and Romans 9 says God hated Esau, because Esau hated God. Okay, and so he's going to get his recompense for his works. All right, we'll stop there for tonight. I know I left a few passages left undealt with, but I trust that you can study those on your own. They will definitely come up again in Obadiah. Talking about how the Lord, when he does return in judgment, is going to come back and he's going to bathe his sword in the blood of Edomia before he comes back to Israel, going to lay them low before he raises up the kingdom of Israel. And Isaiah 63 talks about that. So we'll deal with that a little bit later. All right, any questions, any thoughts about that?